Welcome everybody to the very first Lady Leaders of 2024. We are super excited. We're making some really cool changes. We're updating stuff. And I will say, we've got a really great lineup coming up for the next few months. Some really great things that you guys have asked for, including, you know, Jake Conway next month is going to be talking about some key metrics that people tend to miss, even seasoned people tend to miss and overlook. I know we have Kelly Dove coming on in March, and she's going to talk about how do we hold people accountable when it feels like we're just repeating ourselves all day long. So a lot of things that people are dealing with, I think, on a day-to-day basis, we're going to be covering, and we're going to try to do it succinctly and tactical and really help you guys get out there and make your practices better this year. So on that note, I do want to say, it's funny, you and I have both been asked, you know, on the Lady Leader series, do you have to be a woman doctor, you know, or, you know, a woman to listen? Absolutely not. This is absolutely not for ladies. It's just what we called it because Ash and I host it. But we love having everybody on there. So thank you everybody for listening. So on that note, anything else, Ash, before I dive in?
No, that's just even something we've now learned from everyone we're putting in our marketing. I know I have gents here in our Zoom room with us too. So literally, we are just the lady leaders. And so definitely not just for ladies. And we are happy to have anyone. We enjoy sharing this information and curating this information based off of your needs. And it's truly for anyone. It will help in dentistry, no matter your position, your, you know.
Absolutely.
Whatever it might be.
Yeah, we love when you share it with people too who might need it as well, because sometimes things get buried and we know that. And Ashley's worked really hard on finding ways for you guys to be able to find all these series and go back and easily pull stuff up that maybe you missed the first time. So,
can I actually comment on something that we're working on that we're excited about?
Please.
So we are also working on just putting these specifically on a YouTube channel outside of DSN. Now, obviously, DSN members are going to get the first access. You guys are going to know about them first thing. But if you do want to share it, we are working on getting all of last year's up on a YouTube channel, which we are just really excited about because we know lots of people outside of DSN need this info as well. DSN members get priority because we love our DSN members. But we're going to get this out to as many people as we can.
Absolutely. So share the love for anybody who might need it. It's free. And really, we just care to help as many people as possible. So on that note, you know, one thing that I've noticed is a lot of doctors, a lot of offices are really wanting to, you know, set intention for 2024. They're wanting to create offices that impact their patients bigger. You know, some of their team members, we've talked about, they're getting a little bit of that healthcare fatigue. So jazzing them back up about the impact they can have with the patients. And so, you know, I definitely discussed this back at the summit last year, but it's something that I like to revisit because I find in coaching calls, I talk about it often. And, you know, I know doctors want to give the highest level of patient care always. And I like to assume that their team members do too. But I think sometimes what happens is even as whether you're a small office or as you're growing, we tend to set our focus on way too many things at one time. Okay, now we're talking about perioprotection. Okay, now we're talking about smile perfection. Okay, now let's talk about scanning everybody. And I've noticed that a lot of times doctors will say, like, it's almost like this whack-a-mole thing. We're doing awesome here, but now we forgot to talk about this. We're doing awesome here, but we forgot to talk about this now. Or they'll set goals, you know, or metrics for that month of let's do the most scans. And that's awesome to bring awareness, but sometimes it makes it to where there's just never quite consistency, I think, amongst all the hygienists and the doctors. So, you know, one thing that I have strongly realized over the decades I've been a dentist is that if you can create, you know, I call them optimal care pillars, you can call them whatever you want, optimal care standards, and you have it to where your exams will consistently reflect those standards, no matter what hygienist picks up that exam card or what doctor walks in and does the exam, every time they're gonna be consistent as to when we see blank in a patient, we're gonna offer blank. And it's like a little roadmap, a little consistency map that every time, every patient, they're gonna get a similar experience. And I think that's so important. Like I said, if you're small, this is the perfect time to do it. But if you're starting to grow, you're adding those hygienists or you're adding an associate doc and you're starting to notice that whack-a-mole thing happening, now's the time. So, you know, I'm going to dive into how we kind of define these and give you guys an idea, you know, kind of an idea of how you can start identifying what would be in your office your optimal care standards, your optimal care pillars. And, you know, what I tell doctors and offices is they really first off should reflect the procedures you do, whether you do them a lot or you're wanting to do them more. And so when you think about all the skill set that you have, all the procedures that you can do, that's where we start with what those pillars might be. And what I can say is in our offices, and a lot of people know this because they've seen our pillars, and I think you're going to put them in our, oh goodness, what's that called, Ashley?
In our chat.
In our chat. That's what it's called. You're going to put that, you're going to put my pillars there. But what you're going to see is they're pretty easy in ours. And our whole office knows them by heart, which is soft tissue, hard tissue, occlusion, missing teeth, aesthetics, and airway. Breathing, airway, sleep, something like that. So those are our consistent pillars. And what we do then is we take each of those pillars, because those are the six things that for us are the, you know, optimal standards. We want to get all patients healthy in all of those areas as much as possible. We take each of those pillars though, and we dive a little deeper into, so what does soft tissue really mean? When we get it optimally healthy, we have the highest level of impact. What does each position actually do within that pillar? So we think of soft tissue and we always think of hygienists, right? Well, they're the ones who define perio protocols, or, you know, they're the ones who do therapeutics and laser. And yes, that's all true. But really, what does a treatment coordinator do within soft tissue? Do dental assistants have anything to do with talking to patients about soft tissue? Do the associate docs know everything about what's underneath that pillar? So I think it's important to first start with the procedures that you're capable of doing in your office, and then identify what are all the different areas that for you really matter, really you can make a difference when it comes to a patient's health. And I definitely recommend doctors, it starts with you. Before you throw this out to your team and say, hey, everybody, let's define this. My feeling is, as doctor, I want it to start with you. What does high impact look like, I think, for you first and foremost? Oh, thanks, Ashley. So you can see this is ours, and this is what is up in all our operatories. It's up in our waiting room. There's everybody on the team knows all of these. And, you know, I think that you have to define underneath each of them just a little bit about what that means in terms of what a patient could understand. So we made it kind of patient friendly so a patient can understand what we're saying, but that also makes it to where a treatment coordinator could understand it, a scheduling coordinator could understand it, patients can understand it, everybody, you know, ideally can understand it. But I'm gonna stop there because, you know, Ashley, you've obviously talked to lots of offices over the years and you continue to do so, but have you found that you've walked into offices or you've worked with offices that one of their struggles was clearly defining these? People were kind of all over the place.
Absolutely. And especially as you bring on new team and even like team who have been there for a while, you know what I mean? Like they're going to have different versions of what this means to them, you know? And if you guys listened to us last year or the year before that, we're all about systems, right? And if there's like everything needs a system, and this is just another example of that to get everyone on the same page. Like if I'm the doctor here, Dr. Casmel, if I'm Dr. Summer, I'm like, hey, here's what I'm talking about when I'm talking about, you know, the aesthetic concerns. And this is what the team needs to know about so that they're on the same page. So yes, I see teams struggle with this often.
Yeah. Well, and it's funny because I think a lot of times they'll know the core values and they'll know the mission.
Sure. Which is a good place to start.
Absolutely. I always say, so if they know that, now we're just teaching them how do they deploy that. Exactly. It's through these standards and through these pillars, right? Because most of our missions are really to have these high impact, you know, moments with our patients to really get them as close to optimal care as possible. These pillars are just the way to deploy your core values and your mission every day, in my opinion.
So I love that. That is such a cool way to look at it.
Yeah. So once doctors, you've kind of defined these for yourselves, you have an idea of what they look like. Now, I knew very clearly in my head, this was the six areas that I knew we could help patients with. I then held a meeting and went to the team and let them know, I'm so excited to really create consistency for our patients. Because as we're growing, I want to make sure no patient left behind, you know? We want to make sure that all patients have access to this every time, every provider they see. And so I'm excited to really define these with you. It was then that I was able, even though I had the bones of it, I had a lot of the points of it, I then let them speak into anything that they could see to more clearly define them, more of the why behind them. If your team understands, and really what you're coming from is this place of, I am so excited in 2024 to present this level of impact on my patients, and I know you are too, they're going to get jazzed, you know? And then I think if they're understanding, this has nothing to do with production or revenue or metrics at this point. All it has to do with is we're starting this conversation with our patients. We've always looked at this before, team. You know we have. It's just now we're making it more, we're allowing patients to be more aware of what we've always been doing. We just want them to know, you know, how close we can get them to optimal health for each and every one of them. And I think when teams feel that level of conviction and passion, they know the why behind it. They know that it's important to get patients healthy. I think they truly can rally around that. And, you know, I know for me, everybody knows I love analogies. I love speaking in terms that are as team friendly and patient friendly. Some of them are real misses. I'm not going to lie. I had one just recently and one of my team members was like, wah, wah. I was like, I can't win them all. Right. Exactly. But I'm like, I'm going to just try new stuff. But the one that I do think for some reason has stuck really well with my hygienists and my DAs has been, you know, I tell the team, you know, when a patient comes in, they're always going to come in with some level of dental IQ, some level of what they think optimal care could be like for their mouth. We, as these healthcare professionals, we're sitting with these six standards, knowing actually how healthy we can get a person, that we can catch sleep apnea, that we can catch so many different things just by looking in their mouth. And we know that level of optimal care. We are always just the bridge between them. And I say, team, you know, our goal is we're really just kind of the liaisons who walk beside the patient on the bridge for as far as they want to go. And here's the thing is we don't care how far they want to go. We're just with them every step of the way. If they choose to go halfway, that's their choice. But it's our job just to say we're the bridge to take you as close to optimal care as you want to go. And for me, I find that, you know, the team can almost envision themselves, hey, I'm just walking with you as far as you want to go. It's just my job to tell you this is where we're going and this is what you can do. And if they understand the why behind each of these pillars and they're part of the pillar, like as a DA, here's what I talk about when I talk about occlusion. And it doesn't have to be big and giant and lots of words. It can be really simplistic, but I know my part in that. They want to do that because they want to be part of that bridge. They want to walk beside the patient and get them as healthy as possible. But I think, you know, sometimes we can jump into define the standards, set metrics to it. And I always tell docs, if you can wait just a bit, don't put any KPIs to it yet. Let's really just get excited, start the conversations, identify the pillars, identify what the people are going to be doing and why, get them excited to just start talking about it. I'm like, just start there. But Ashley, you know, you're shaking your head. Obviously, what do you see in this first meeting when we're introducing something like this? What do you think could go wrong or go very right?
Well, I think it's, I mean, the book Start With Why, right? Like there's a reason that that's like a best-selling book is the Start With Why. If your team is on board with why this is happening, then, you know, they're going to be more apt to communicate that as well. I love that analogy of like, we're here to walk you as far as you want to go. Ooh, I think you're on fire today with your analogies. 2024 is the year of summer analogies. I love it.
And I'm warning you, I got sleep last night. So,
ooh, she got it. I think that it's, you know, understanding the why, the what. If you can explain to someone, you know, get them on board with those things instead of putting the pressure on your team, like your goal is to hit this number, you know, and going back to the basics and that foundation of your core values and your mission and the why behind it and helping them to understand their part in that. I think that's just going to be I don't think, I know because I've seen it, just play a much better role in the building of a practice.
Yeah, I think so too. And that's what I've seen is always when I press the metrics before I press the understanding and enthusiasm piece, I lose them really quickly. And it becomes demotivating versus motivating for them. So, you know, I think at this point you've had this meeting, you've jazzed them up, whether that's an hour, 2 hour, whatever your team meetings are. I think you can let them know, hey, this is just the beginning. I'm going to work on a few things behind the scenes, and then I'm going to meet with each of you department by department so that I can dig in with you personally so that you know what your part is of each of these pillars and anything, you know, tactical paperwork, anything I need to give you to help you with this. So really that first meeting is to jazz them up, let them know what's going on, you know, get them excited about it. And then you can start to dig into more of those department meetings. And I know it sounds crazy, but yes, I went through it with scheduling coordinators. I do think that it starts at the very first phone call. And, you know, I remember a couple years ago, I had one of my brand new scheduling coordinators who they don't get to answer the phone right away. They have to go through some training, but it was pretty neat when Nicole picked up the phone and it was a new patient. And, you know, she said Castle Peak Dental, you know, she did her thing and it was a new patient. We're so excited to have you. You know, we're just not like other practices, or we may be very different than other practices because here's all the different areas. She was so excited to talk to this patient about, here's all the areas we look at. We can't wait to meet you. And, you know, she was just going on and on. But I was thinking to myself, like, when a scheduling coordinator is that excited to tell a new patient about it, we've done something right. So I think it's important to make sure scheduling coordinators, treatment coordinators, sterile techs, associate docs, it doesn't matter who, everybody should be involved department by department of what's their part in this. Because if a brand new scheduling coordinator can be that excited, I think anybody can. So yeah, Ashley, go
for it. And I have to add on to that too, because I loved what you said of like, you know, do they have like the right forms to show them and the right tools to show them, something that I preach about often, and it goes with any type of delegation in the dental office or, you know, admin office, like, are you giving your team the right tools to be successful in their role? So if you're like, oh, my personal assistant is not booking the right flights, but your personal assistant doesn't have a computer fast enough to, you know, do a good search and it's taking them forever, that could be different. You know, are you giving them the tools? And so in this phase, you know, are you giving that assistant, you know, images to show them, like, here's what, here are the things we look for in that broken tooth, in the receding gums, and like, here are the types of things that we look for. Are you giving them the tools to be as successful as possible in that role? I think that's a really important step that sometimes they miss. And I think, yes, I just love that.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Well, and it's funny because like, I made it so simple for the hygienists and the DAs of like, when it comes to occlusion, I'm like, here's the 6 bullet points you're looking for. I had them laminated and in their rooms. And it's funny, I could see them opening the doors just so they could double check, oh, ab fractions, that's a sign, you know? Yeah, yeah. And I think sometimes we overcomplicate it. And I'm always thinking to myself, how simple can I make it? I'm gonna try to oversimplify if I possibly can. So when you're meeting with those departments, you're really digging into what their part can do to have impact. And here's the tools you have, or here's how I can explain it. And I will tell you, it's super important, practice the verbiage, you know? A lot of times I think what happens is people want to go out and deploy this message. They're excited, but when they stumble over their verbiage, when a patient acts a little weird or a patient says something maybe not that they were hoping for, it can derail them. So I think it's so important to practice verbiage with them. Hey, what if Bob, you know, a perfect example is like when I was talking to the hygienist, they all said, you know, I think this is super easy with a new patient. They read it. They see it in my op. I can tell them about it. Hey, these are the 6 areas I'm going to be looking at. So if you hear me talking about it, you'll know. They were like, that's super easy. What's hard is I've been seeing Bob. I mean, you know, Amy, everybody knows Amy. Amy's like, I've been seeing Bob for 20 years. Why all of a sudden am I going to be telling Bob about this? So we had to practice the verbiage, which really I do make it as easy as saying, you know, hey, Bob, you and I have been a team for 20 years. And what I want to tell you is I've actually been looking at all of these areas pretty consistently for those 20 years. And as I learned more, I tried to notice more things in your mouth. But here's the thing I've realized is I have failed to always make you aware of what I'm seeing. So now I'm just going to make you aware of what I was always doing in the first place. So that way Bob's not sitting there thinking, well, wait a minute, are you trying to all of a sudden sell me stuff?
Just trying to sell me something. That's always a thing, right?
Yep. And that's what hygienists, so we practice that verbiage so that when they walked into it, now listen, I remember, because I'm going to tell you about what happens, because you don't just do this one time and then it's done. My team loves to make fun of me and they literally are like, do you want to do the optimal care pillars again? Like for the 77th time. And sometimes joke. I like go cross-eyed and I'm like, no, you know, but it is something that we repeat often. And as we get new team members, we repeat often. But, you know, in that department head meeting, you need to practice the verbiage. You need to practice potentially what are going to be objectives and how to handle them. Make sure, I know this sounds silly, but like talk about setting them up for success with resources. Make sure codes are incorrectly, costs are incorrectly. You walk through treatment planning. So if you're going to do the soft tissue pillar, and that is obviously a very dominant hygiene one, it's time to spend time in there and make sure they have all those tools and resources. If they are supposed to have impact with doing therapeutics or laser, is everything readily available? Is it easy for them to push some explosion codes and treatment plan it? Is it easy for them to get consent forms? Is all of that ready to go? And have we practiced the verbiage around all of those? Those meetings aren't like flybys. Those meetings are like, let's sit and go through this and make sure you're ready to go. You know, and like I said, this isn't a one and done thing. I always tell people, we're going to talk about it now, and then we're going to check in next week. Just at lunch, we're going to do a, you know, a 30-minute check-in to see what were the objections? What were the things that didn't go well? Just so that we can come up with collectively as a group of hygienists, you know, what are the solutions for this week? And, you know, when we're deploying some of those tools underneath each pillar with whatever department, one of the tools that you're going to deploy likely with your hygienist is another, on the chat we put also my hygiene exam card. The hygiene exam card is really just reflective of exactly those six pillars. And if you look at it, it literally just goes in line with hard tissue, soft tissue, missing teeth, occlusion, aesthetics, airway, so that when a hygienist has it, and you can see there's two of them, you know, they just cut them in half. Yes, you can laminate them. People have asked me, like, isn't that a lot of paper you're wasting? I have hygienists who cut them, laminate them. I have ones who they actually really do like to write on the paper because they use it for their notes. I'm not here to tell you how to do it, but these are just ours. And as we've added doctors, as we've added hygienists, we found, as you can see, starting from top to bottom, it's nice for doctors to know if they've met that patient before, because I don't know about you guys, but as you add more doctors, I've had doctors where they walk in and they say, nice to meet you. And the patient's like, you saw me last week for a crown. So for us, we even like to know, like, have we met them? Were x-rays, you know, taken today? Did you already take the IO photos and review them? Chief complaint, oral cancer, soft tissue, hard tissue, occlusion, aesthetics, missing teeth, breathing. And you can see we have a couple other little things like, does the doctor need to reinforce fluoride? Yes or no, meaning the hygienist has had to talk to that patient about, this would really help you as a recommendation. It'd be great if the doctor comes in and just reinforces it. But truly, this is just a reflection of those pillars. And like I said, the pillars are just a way to deploy really the impact and mission you're trying to have on the patients. This exam form allows no matter what hygienist to come in. The nice thing is too, is they have a framework. A new hygienist knows right from the beginning. And sometimes, you know, people have said, well, don't they get overwhelmed? They're going to get overwhelmed no matter what. They're going to be overwhelmed no matter what if they're starting in a new place. So we always tell new hygienists, this is just your scaffolding. This is just your framework. You're not always going to make it all the way through, because you might have a new patient, you know, that you start with soft tissue. They have four quads of SRP. You go to hard tissue, go to T stuff, and you're like, holy smokes, fires everywhere. You might not even get past that point. That's as far along the bridge as you get in that appointment. And we tell our hygienists that. So new hygienists as well, you may not get all the way, but then we're going to make sure in our notes that we say, we weren't able to talk about these pillars. We'll revisit those after all the fires are out, no emergencies, all infection is done. We'll start back with occlusion, you know, if need be or whatever. So I think after you've set the pillars, you've had one big team meeting to, you know, talk about them and let them know, I'm going to be meeting with all of you department by department. You can then jump into those department head meetings, ready with tools, resources, what is your impact and what you're going to work on for just that week. Mm. Ashley, I'll stop there before.
Just to add on to the, you know, are they overwhelmed when you start? I see it in all types of positions that we hire for. People would rather be overwhelmed by things that have structure than overwhelmed by things that don't. And they're forced to create it because that's another level of overwhelm. Like, we don't have a system here. We need you to just like understand what's going on. That is far more overwhelming than the system that has structure and this checklist. Like, at least at the very least, I know which things I'm checking off. I know what I'm looking for. I know what my doctor expects. Yeah, it may be a lot, but at least I have a baseline. I have some place to start instead of like just going in and winging it, because that's an additional level of overwhelm that people in new positions don't appreciate.
I couldn't agree more, because if they don't even know what a doctor is expecting in their exams, I think that does add that extra layer of they want to be so great, but they don't know how, you know? Yeah. And you know, for us, I think the nice thing is when we're interviewing hygienists, we know we have this system. So we can talk to hygienists about, these are the areas that matter to us. Is this something, much like core values, do these resonate with you? And we've had ones when we're interviewing hygienists who say, I'll be honest, I've never been in an office that talks about sleep. I don't even know anything about it. And we say, great, do you want to learn? Yeah, that sounds great. Awesome. Then that's us. That's the magic we love to bring and help hygienists understand. So I think for me, you know, having this sort of optimal care really just plants a flag in the ground of who we are, the impact we have, and gives every position just a way to be able to deliver that to patients consistently. And when you're hiring, it just lets them know, once again, this is kind of who we are and what we stand for. So I couldn't agree more. I think they're going to be overwhelmed no matter what. So at least have a system for them to begin to follow, I think. So you know, at that point, they're going to deploy, they're going to go out, they're going to be carrying out this mission, they're going to be trying to talk about these standards. And I will tell you from experience, I had some hygienists, I'm literally next door to one, who, I mean, it was like, literally Kylie was like, I get it all. She went out and she was like a goddess with it, right? I had other ones, you know, DAs, hygienists, who were a little more clunky with it, needed a little extra time. It's not a competition. There's no metrics. There's no nothing. But we would meet the next week and we'd check in. All right, hygienists, let's have our lunch together and talk about, what did you see? What got in your way? What can I do to help? And week by week, as we did that, pretty soon everybody was off and running. And now they teach it to the next hygienist. They teach it to the next DAs. And it gets easier with that repetition. But I think that repetition is so important, because I think what happens is, how many times, and we all know the funny joke of like, you know, doctors become in all hot and excited about something. We throw it down. We have the one meeting. It kind of fizzles out and we're like, why is nobody doing it? And I'm like, I hate to say it, but it's us as the doctors. You know, if you're going to really want to see, you know, if your goal in 2024 is to increase revenues or increase dollar per exam, which for me is a really big metric, mm-hmm. you know, not even case acceptance, just truly what you're even treatment planning, this is the thing that will change it. But just like anything, if you want it to change it for good, you're going to have to put the time and intention into training everybody repeatedly on it.
Repeatedly. But, I love that you said repeatedly, and I will harp on that. Repeatedly.
It is. And I mean, truly, like I said, I mean, my team was making fun of me. Because yeah. I mean, there was times, guys, I cannot tell you how much I didn't want to go over it again. Optimal care pillars for the 67th time, you know? Yeah. But what's funny is every time I did, they could actually see how passionate I was about it. And I know Debbie, even, who's been with me forever, was like, every time you do it, I learn it a different way. I hear it a different way. I get more excited in a different way. So, you know, I think it's important to repeat it for yourself and them and doctors, that this is the mission. This is who we are. And like I said, the flag we plant. So, you know, after a few weeks, what I'll say is, you know, in my opinion, is I would give it a month. I'd have the meeting. I'd have the interdepartmental meetings, and I'd do at least a couple follow-ups with them before I would deploy metrics. And I know how much doctors want to see instantaneous improvement. How many lasers did we do? How much whatever did we sell? How many implant consults? And I love that. I love that. But I'm always like, if you can just go slow to go fast, I promise it'll be worth it. In my opinion, what I've seen is if we can take the time to invest in the people, the training, the conversations without that sense of metrics, I think then you can deploy the metrics and say, you know, have those fun contests or, you know, whatever it may be, you can put metrics to fluoride sold or lasers done or just number of people you got healthy with an implant. Whatever it may be, I think then it can become fun for them because they're not so overwhelmed just trying to figure out codes and where stuff is and how to say it. They're actually to the point where now they're excited to have maybe more of those metrics. So, you know, I don't know about you, Ashley, what you've seen when it comes to trying to take an office and embed a whole system to it that's consistent, but tell me along the way, what have you seen with metrics tracking too early, too late, that kind of stuff, too late, whatever?
Well, I feel like, you know, people think we're in cahoots, but like, I just absolutely agree with everything that you're saying. Like, later, it's no, you know, surprise that Summer and I do webinars together because we agree on many things. And this is the case as well. I love the, you know, give them time to learn the system before you start putting the pressure on them of those metrics. And you mentioned the go slow to go fast. And what I think it's the Marines as slow as smooth and smooth as fast. Shout out Spencer Greer just posted that quote in our endo room this week as well, because it's true. Like in everything, like just take the time to go a little slow in the beginning to then let it rip, you know, once everything has kind of laid down. So I mean, I can only echo what you're saying, and I agree with everything you're saying.
Well, and I know
you're not even paying me, guys. I just agree with everything you're saying.
We talk a lot too. We've worked together a long time, so we do have similar philosophies. But well, and I think we've both seen, you know, through coaching so many offices, you with team and doctors, me with doctors, obviously in teams too. But I think we've just seen, you know, and I am so guilty. I mean, I joined DSI and I was like, I want it all right now, and I threw everything and tried to do it as fast as possible. And you know, I'm so grateful that I didn't have mass like quittings, but I definitely had to be pulled aside and be like, we love you, but this isn't going to work. So, you know, so I think what I just went, you know, what I just, you know, talked about with the optimal care standards is exactly how I did it. And I still revisit them years later. They're still in our operatories. They're still what we talk about. There's still things that I have to revisit. You know, when I do my associate doc weekly check-ins, you know, on their little meeting agenda, that's one of their questions is, let's go back and look at the treatment tracker to see how well did we discuss the care pillars? Are we losing impact? Are we losing, you know, patients and not giving them the very best standards consistently? So for me, it just has really helped kind of keep, like I said, being our North Star when it comes to our standards of care. And I hope for, you know, the people who are listening or will listen, I hope we walked through that well enough that, you know, and the resources we put on the chat, you know, you guys can really go and kind of start doing this for yourself with your 2024 goals. So anything else, Ash, before we wrap
up? No, I think, I love that this is a start with why situation, you know, clinically. It's not just like the reason behind it is because we love our patients and we want to make a difference in the community. Of course, that's the reason. But like, here are the things we're looking for specifically in our jobs as dental professionals. I like that, you know, I love anything tactical. And I love, again, we're going to put this in the chat and DSN. But, you know, here are the things that we're using and we're looking for. I guess my only question for you is, has this six pillars changed for you over your, you know, years? Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and I think even at the summit, what I said is like, you know, when I started, I probably had like four of those pillars, maybe three. I don't know. Cause that's just really my skill set. I didn't know at the time, you know, I didn't use Invisalign for occlusion stuff. So it should be, you know, rediscovered every year. Are there new things we're adding? You know, I know my hygiene team is always looking to add stuff. And we've had so many wonderful webinars with Rachel Wall that if you're not changing stuff up, you know, go back and find those ones with Rachel Wall. Because if you're not changing up how you care for people's soft tissue, we should be. So I think every year we definitely look through and see, are there things that we could be doing different to have bigger impact? So.
Perfect. I love it.
Yeah. Well, everybody, like I said, get excited. We have some really great stuff in store for the year. Next month, like I said, will be Jake Conway talking about key metrics that people miss in their practices, even experienced business owners. So if you have any questions, please put them in the chat. We always love to hear them. And as always, thank you guys for tuning in. Thank you, Ashley, for being co-host with me.
Of course. Of course. Thank you for having me, Summer. And I'm so excited for 2024.
I know. Yay. All right. Bye, guys.